Hey guys, what's up? Welcome back to the channel. It's Cidic Alex, and today I want to try something new. We do the first impressions videos at the beginning of an update, and I give them my feedback. I think this is good. I think this is great. I think this is kind of so-so. And then we spend the next, week or two going through videos, deep dive, testing these characters out with different obelisks, different CTPs. We max them out, max out their builds, etc. And we try to crown sort of winners and losers to an extent. Not so much losers, but, characters that maybe, or uniforms or whatever, that are not as good, game modes that have, hit or miss, etc. And so what I want to try and do today, and maybe if this becomes popular, I can do this every update if you guys like it, is do sort of a recap and essentially crown the winners and losers and give you sort of the final thoughts and give each of the new uniforms and each of the new game mode changes or what have you, new events, give them a letter grade to more quickly and easily summarize, I think this is really good. It's A+ or whatever. I think this is kind of it's kind of mid. It's like a B+. I think this is kind of bad. It's like a C or whatever type thing. So hit me up in the comments down below at the end of the video. Of course, watch the video. Don't start giving me your opinions now. Watch some of the video. Watch all the video. And if you like it, give it a thumbs up. If you don't like it, give it a thumbs down or whatever. And hit me up in the comments with thoughts that you have on the type of video. So we're just gonna go through the uniforms first, and then we're gonna talk about the new. It's not really a game mode, but the new piece of content. In the crafting event that it was made specifically for this update and we've never seen before. So first off, we have Quicksilver. This uniform was notable because it is a native tier 2 uniform. Speed types have still been needing some buffs here and there, despite Captain America Falcon, despite Winter Soldier, despite, Rogue a few months ago. Speed types still feel kind of weak, and Quicksilver is a pretty popular, long-standing native tier 2 that I think a lot of players own. But the cons with this uniform are honestly that it just doesn't go far enough for the character. It adds some effects, but it takes away a lot of effects, and it doesn't really make him stand out in any way. And the price tag, combined with the price tag of $1,750, it really just does not make him an exciting purchase. And it really doesn't seem like he's going to add enough to your roster to really do very much for you. So I honestly think this uniform is kind of a miss. I think I would give this about a B- or a C+ rating. I think the devs could have or should have done a little bit more for him and pushed him a little bit further. And it doesn't really matter the PvE, PvP direction. I would have preferred PvE because we've seen him dominate in PvP years ago. But I think these sorts of exclusive uniforms, they need to be good. Obviously, you're running a very fine line, right? You don't want them to be too good, especially the paid ones like Silk, etc. You don't want them to be too good that they're ruining the balance of characters, because then you start to get into like power creep and pay to win territory, right? But you need them to be good enough. They need to be good enough. And so it's a difficult job. I don't envy the devs that have to do the balancing, but I think they should look at this one and say, we were close, but not quite, right? I think they were about 80% of the way there, but I think they needed to just give Quicksilver that last 20% push, and this uniform would have been hype as heck. And it would be giving it an A+. Speaking of A+, I think they definitely nailed it with this one. This is an example. Silk's uniform is definitely an example of walking that fine line between making something that costs real money, so it's got that pay to win jingle just around the corner, and making her very strong, but not too strong, right? Not too strong. You still need to transcend Silk. You still need to give her a good build, still need to give her a CTP, but she can now compete with characters like, she can now compete with characters like Rogue. So that's a really good balancing, because Rogue came out, 4 or 5 months ago. So you don't want Silk to be worse than Rogue, right? The last thing you want is a new uniform, a new character, so to speak, to be automatically weaker than another character from months before. It just doesn't make sense. They should either be the same, or she should be just a little bit stronger. And again, she might not need to be stronger if she's stronger in a different game mode or a different aspect of the game. So, if Rogue's really good for World Boss Legend, World Boss Ultimate, Mephisto, Squad Battle, maybe they want to make Silk really dominant for Alliance Conquest, etc. Some other content, right? Timeline Battle. That's not the case. But I'm just saying that this uniform is definitely the best example of walking that fine line and getting it right. She's not so broken that you're like, everybody's got to buy this uniform, bro. I don't care if you're free to play. Go rob somebody's wallet. Go, come on, get to the bank, mow your mother, father, brother, sister's lawn. Go, it's not like that, right? So they've really balanced it properly, and you know, just top to bottom, this uniform looks good when you see it here. It's got good visuals and unique visuals on the skills, like Coastal Explosion and Spider Splash. That's another important thing, right? People don't think it's really important, but it is. If I'm gonna pay premium for a uniform, I want to see something I'm not gonna see on another character. So you can't just copy and paste all the skills. You can copy and paste some of the skills, but you got to show me something new, right? You got to give me some taste. And then, of course, the production. Very, very strong character, and does not need to have an absolutely max build in order to get there. Even with a so-so build, she can still perform very well. That's definitely an A-plus uniform. Really good. Up next, we have Hulkbuster. Now, this one is interesting. I think Hulkbuster and Rescue are experiments, so to speak, and I think these are successful experiments. However, I would still say that they missed the mark by a little bit, and I am being very critical. But I'm doing that because I want to see more of these types of uniforms. What am I talking about here? Well, basically, these uniforms combine strong core reworks to the character's own function, i.e. like how you play the character in content when you're controlling the character, but they also provide auxiliary benefits in the form of really strong passives that create a sort of team up strategy, a sort of thematic synergy, which is so cool, and we love to see that. You know, we've been talking for so long about how the ability tags, it applies to all Fantastic Four members, and you've got the Fantastic Four leadership, or it applies to all, you know, symbiotes, right? So the leader of the symbiotes, of course, is going to buff the symbiotes, and so now you're just looking for new characters that are going to come out with that symbiote tag, like Gwenom and stuff like that. We love that. Now we're seeing it in another flavor where it's like, okay, all technokinetic allies. So this is not just new characters that are coming out with this tag. We're going to go back and fish out lots of old characters like Dr. Octopus, Ultron, etc. This is really cool. But then they layer it and they take it a step further by giving some specific buffs. And then in Rescue's case, they give some generic buffs because this is all allies. So it provides a layer of creativity, which sort of can sometimes be against the layer of flexibility. Because the more creative you want to get, he's got one of the most creative leaderships in the game, the more specific you're going to get, right? Which can be good, can be bad. Then you get less creative, but you get, I mean, it's still creative in a way, but it's much more generic, and it's really good because it can apply to all allies. So I honestly think I would rate these uniforms the same. Again, neither one of these uniforms is going to knock your socks off in terms of their core function when you're playing as the character. They're both good reworks. They're both solid reworks. I would give them B pluses. I would say keep all of the passives the same, keep all of the leaderships the same, keep all of those support buffs the same, but just tweak their own production, their own damage a little bit. Like I said, 10%, and I think these would be absolute banger uniforms. But whereas Rescue is basically as good as Quasar on her own, then you're left with just getting this one. If you really like the leadership and you really want to toy around with that kind of stuff, it kind of limits their value for some players because some players are just looking for a bigger stick every time. So you kind of want to give them the best of both worlds. It's a tough job, but I think they did a good job. Last but not least, we have Dr. Doom. We can't talk about War Machine yet, sadly. So Dr. Doom gets this new uniform, absolutely blows up the meta, but that's what you expect, right? Every once in a while, you do need to break the mold. You do need to break that fine line of balancing a uniform that costs a lot with a character that costs even more and power level. Sometimes you just need to do that because you need to establish that the character is worth getting. And I think it's especially important for the devs to recognize that these characters that are locked at the end of this long, expensive road, right? He's literally, Owen Reese, Molecule Man, is literally the most expensive character in this game because you need to invest in all of these characters. You've got 3,000 CCF Blondie Boy over there, and on the other end, you've got Blondie Girl that costs 6,600 crystals. And in between, you got a whole bunch of other clowns costing you gold, biometrics, you know, tons of energy farming, weeks, months waiting for bios to drop in the case of Ares, and then you're using mega rank up tickets on him, right? All this investment. So the character at the end of the road needs to be overpowered because otherwise you're not giving people an incentive to actually go ahead and build the character. So hopefully we'll see the same type of rework for Gladiator. You know, these characters do essentially need to be a cut above because otherwise it just doesn't make any sense. Why would you ask players to go on this journey if the thing at the end of the journey doesn't justify the journey, right? The reward at the end has to justify the effort you put in. And Marvel Future Fight has struggled with that in the past, where the journey is hard, and what you get at the end is not worth it. You know, bad rewards for difficult game modes. ABX is a perfect example, but they're definitely doing a lot better nowadays, and Dr. Doom is the perfect example. This is an S-tier uniform. This is an S-tier rework. Top to bottom, he gets changes. He's very strong for all content. You can basically, you have your choice, right? You get to be the master to choose, you know, do I want to build my Dr. Doom for this? Do I want to build him for that? You can even go ahead, be cheeky, and build him for both. You can build him for PvE, and he can still function in PvP with certain builds. So this is really the definition of those like super prizes that you need to drop every once in a while. You don't want to see these uniforms dropping every update, right? Some players will say they want a Dr. Doom type uniform every update. I don't think we really need that. But every other update is fine, or every two updates is fine. Really just a way to, you know, keep people understanding that, you know, if I'm going to work hard to build up these super powerful, super strong characters, they are going to reward me with a lot of value long term. So that's it for the uniforms. Last but not least, we have the crafting event. Now, I've given out different rankings from C all the way to S, but I gotta say, this crafting event is S plus. This is one of the coolest, and I do not mean that with sarcasm or a pun intended. This is one of the coolest events I've seen in any game. It allows you to gamble, right? Take a risk, burn some of your precious resources for a super mega prize that you can't even buy, right? These are prizes that are not even sold in the shop. That's how rare they are. Or you can play it safe and you can use those materials that you can farm for freely. So you can enjoy this update either way. You can enjoy this event either way, and you can use those to farm up valuable resources and basically stockpile. So it's really got something for everyone. For the more casual players, they can just do a little bit of dispatch farming, whatever. They can get some extra ice cream cones. They can convert them into these chests, and they can just get some free resources. You don't actually have to invest anything in this event to get something out of it. Right? You can just invest some energy in dispatch, but you're getting other rewards from dispatch anyways, right? You're getting dispatch XP, drops, etc. Or if you're feeling lucky, punk, you can go ahead and gamble for one of the higher tier rewards, and you can come up empty, which is always the case when you're risking it all, or you can get lucky. Let's see if we get lucky here. We have a few more crafts. Let's just fly through this. No, okay. So it's really got something for everyone. It's got something for free-to-plays, it's got something for mid-spenders, it's got something for whales. I think this is the perfectly designed event. I really have nothing bad to say about it whatsoever. The only criticism I would have to say, if I had one criticism, is make that red text there a little bit bigger, where it says there's a chance to fail. Just make that a little bit bigger and you're good. But otherwise, this event is amazing. Maybe they could reduce the gold cost a little bit for some of these items, for some of the crafting. That's probably the only other criticism I would have. But yeah, I strongly hope, like I really hope they make these ones again, like they do these events again, because this is the first time we see it, and hopefully it won't be the last, because I think it's really, really fun, and I think it's really engaged the community in a way that we haven't seen the community engaged before with these types of events. Last but not least, we actually have War Machine. Now, I obviously can't talk too much about this uniform because we haven't seen it in action. Obviously, in the skill preview, it looks really good, but I've played this game long enough to know that looks can be deceiving. Now, I'm not saying that this uniform isn't going to be good. I'm just saying that we have to wait and see. And it's only a few days away anyway, so there's no point in doing a deep dive on a uniform that I've never actually played with. However, I will tentatively give it a hypothetical rank of S. I hope that I'm right on that one. You tell me what you think this uniform is going to be. Is it going to be B tier, A tier, S tier, or somehow higher than S tier, S plus? So yeah. Let me know what you think of this sort of recap. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in the next one. Take care.